Hi guys, Miss Davis. It's good to see you all today. I'm here for day four of the Anne Frank series, and we're gonna hop right into it, pick up where we left off yesterday. No skipping today. The first thing I want to talk about is that yesterday I was really sort of moved by how much grace and poise Anne was really handling so many changes so fast and moving into the secret annex and packing all of her belongings into a single satchel and moving to this place that she had no idea and where she was going or where it was or what was going to meet her there. She had so many questions but couldn't ask anybody the answers to them. So that was what I was thinking about yesterday, and today that sort of continues with a little bit more deep thoughts. And so we'll just hop right into it. The diary entry for today is dated Friday, July 10th, 1942. Dear Kitty, I have thoroughly bored you with my long-winded descriptions of our dwelling, but I still think you should know where we've landed. Switch myself here. There we go. But to continue my story, you see, I'm not finished yet. When we arrived at the Prisengracht, Meep took us quickly upstairs and into the secret annex. She closed the door behind us, and we were alone. Margot was already waiting for us, having to come much faster on her bicycle. Our living room and all the other rooms were chock-full of rubbish. Indescribably so. All the cardboard boxes which had been sent to the office in the previous months lay piled on the floor and the beds. The little room was filled to the ceiling with bedclothes. We had to start clearing up immediately if we wished to sleep in decent beds that night. Mummy and Margot were not in a fit state to take part. They were tired and lay down on their beds. They were miserable and lots more besides. But the two cleaners up of the family, Daddy and myself, wanted to start at once. The whole day long we unpacked boxes, filled cupboards, hammered and tidied until we were dead beat. We sank into clean beds that night. We hadn't had a bit of anything warm the whole day, but we didn't care. Mummy and Margot were too tired and keyed up to eat, and Daddy and I were too busy. On Tuesday morning we went on where we left off the day before. Eli and Meep collected our rations for us. Daddy improved the poor blackout, we scrubbed the kitchen floor, and we were on the go the whole day long again. I hardly had time to think about the great change in my life until Wednesday. Then I had a chance, and for the first time since our arrival, to tell you about it, and at the same time to realize myself what had actually happened to me and what was still going to happen. Yours, Anne. So that's the end of that journal entry, and I find myself again, just amazed at her attitude for this whole thing. And I think that probably her mother and sister's tiredness had not a lot to do with being tired and very much more to do with being terribly depressed and overwhelmed. And she sort of says, "Let me do what I can." And that's an attitude that I can appreciate and sometimes do that myself, you know, like kick into overdrive on little things that I can do instead of focusing on the things that I can't. So I find that as a place where I can identify with Anne at that spot, and also sort of endearing to me for her. So the next entry is Saturday, the 11th of July, 1942. Dear Kitty, Daddy, Mummy, and Margot can't get used to the sound of the Western clock yet, which tells us the time every quarter of an hour. I can. I've loved it from the start, and especially in the night. It's like a faithful friend. I expect you will be interested to hear what it feels like to disappear. Well, all I can say is that I don't know myself yet. I don't think I shall ever feel really at home in this house, but that doesn't mean that I loathe it here. It is more like being on vacation in a very peculiar boarding house. Rather a mad idea, perhaps, but that's how it strikes me. The secret annex is an ideal hiding place. Although it leans to one side and is damp, you'd never find such a comfortable hiding place anywhere in Amsterdam. No, perhaps not even in the whole of Holland. Our little room looked very bare at first with nothing on the walls, but thanks to Daddy, who had broadened my film star collection and picture postcards on beforehand, and with the aid of paste pot and brush, I have transformed the walls into one gigantic picture. This makes it look much more cheerful, and when the Van Dans come, we'll get some wood from the attic and make a few little cupboards for the walls and other odds and ends to make it look more lively. Margot and Mummy are a little bit better now. Mummy felt well enough to cook some soup for the first time yesterday, but then, forgot all about it while she was downstairs, so the peas were burned to a cinder and utterly refused to leave the pan. Mr. Cuffius has brought me a book called Young People's Annual. The four of us went to the private office yesterday evening and turned on the radio. I was so terribly frightened that someone might hear it that I simply begged Daddy to come upstairs with me. Mumby understood how I felt and came too. We are very nervous in other ways, too, that the neighbors might hear us or see something going on. We made curtains straight away on the first day. Really, one can hardly call them curtains. They're just light, loose strips of material, all different shapes, quality, and pattern, which Daddy and I sewn together in the most unprofessional way. These works of art are fixed in position with drawing pins, not to come down until we emerge from here. There are some large business premises on the right of us, and on the left, a furniture shop. There's no one there after working hours, but even so, sounds could travel through the walls. We have forbidden Margot to cough at night, although she has a bad cold, and make her swallow large doses of codeine. I'm looking for Tuesday when the Van Dans arrive. It will be much more fun and not so quiet. It's the silence that frightens me so in the evenings and at night. I wish, like anything, that one of our protectors could sleep here at night. I can't tell you how oppressive it is to never be able to go outdoors. Also, I'm very afraid that we shall be discovered and be shot. It's not exactly a pleasant prospect. We have to whisper and tread lightly during the day. Otherwise, the people in the warehouse might hear us. Someone is calling me. Yours, Anne. That last couple of lines really just, like, that tears me up. I can sort of identify with the idea of not being able to go out, although I'm not that terribly oppressed. If I want to go outside, I can. I'm supposed to social distance. So it really puts in perspective this whole social distancing thing for me, because if these people can do that and endure that of having to be quiet so that they're never heard, and the constant fear of being discovered and shot by the Gestapo, like, I just can't even really wrap my head around that. So I admire them, and it gives me fortitude that I can do whatever I'm being asked to do right now, because other people have certainly endured far worse. I want to read a couple more journal entries. This one's dated Friday, August 14th, 1942. Dear Kitty, I have deserted you for a whole month, but honestly, there's so little news here that I can't find any amusing things to tell you every day. The Van Dans arrived on July 13th. We thought they were coming on the 14th, but between the 13th and 16th of July, the Germans called up people right and left, which created more and more unrest. So they played for safety. Better a day or two early than a day too late. At 9:30 in the morning, we were still having breakfast. Peter arrived, the Van Dans' son, not yet 16, a rather soft, shy, gawky youth. Can't expect much from his company. He brought his cat, Mushi, with him. Mr. and Mrs. Van Dan arrived half an hour later, and to our great amusement, she had a large potty in her hat box. I don't feel at home anywhere without my chamber, she declared, so it was the first thing to find its permanent resting place under her divan. Mr. Van Dan did not bring his, but carried a folding tea table under his arm. From the day they arrived, we all had meals cozily together, and after 3 days, it was just as if we were one large family. Naturally, the Van Dans were able to tell us a lot about the extra week they'd spent in the inhabited world. Among other things, we were very interested to hear what had happened to our house and to Mr. Goudsmit, Mr. Van Dan told us. Mr. Goudsmit phoned at 9 o'clock on Monday morning and asked if I could come around. I went immediately and found G in a state of great agitation. He let me read a letter that the Franks had left behind and wanted to take the cat to the neighbors, as indicated in the letter, which pleased me. Mr. G was afraid that the house would be searched, so we went through all the rooms, tidied up a bit, and cleared away the breakfast things. Suddenly, I discovered a writing pad on Mrs. Frank's desk with an address in Maastricht written on it. Although I knew that this was done on purpose, I pretended to be very surprised and shocked, and urged Mr. G to tear off this unfortunate little piece of paper without delay. I went on pretending that I knew nothing of your disappearance all the time, but after seeing the paper, I got a brainwave. Mr. Goudsmit, I said, it suddenly dawns on me that what this new address may refer to. Now it all comes back to me. A high-ranking officer was in the office about 6 months ago. He appeared to be very friendly with Mr. Frank and offered to help him should the need arise. He was stationed in Maastricht. I think he must have kept his word and somehow or other managed to get them into Belgium and then onto Switzerland. I should tell this to any friends who may inquire. Don't, of course, mention Maastricht. With these words, I left the house. Most of your friends know already, because I've told myself several times by different people. We were highly amused at the story, and when Mr. Van Dam gave us further details, laughed still more at the way people can let their imagination run away with them. One family had seen the pair of us pass on bicycles very early in the morning, and another lady knew quite definitely that we were fetched by a military car in the middle of the night. Yours, Anne. So this journal entry sort of goes over their covering of their tracks and how they sort of are trying to lead the Gestapo or people behind them on the wrong path, thinking maybe they've left the country when really they're very much inside the country, just in hiding. So again, the degree of sophistication it takes to hide from the Nazis strikes me, and the fact that it's such dangerous times for them. The last journal entry I want to read today is dated Friday, August 21st, 1942. Dear Kitty, the entrance to our hiding place has now been properly concealed. Mr. Crailer thought it would be better to put a cupboard in front of our door, because a lot of houses are being searched for hidden bicycles. But of course, it had to be a movable cupboard that can open like a door. Mr. Vossen made the whole thing. We had already let him into the secret, and he can't do enough to help. If we want to go downstairs, we have to first bend down and then jump because the step is gone. The first 3 days, we were all going about with masses of lumps on our foreheads because we knocked ourselves against the low doorway. Now we've nailed a cloth filled with wood wool against the top of the door. Let's see if that helps. I'm not working much at present. I'm giving myself holidays until September. Then Daddy's going to give me lessons. It's shocking how much I've forgotten already. There is little change in our life here. Mr. Van Dan and I usually manage to upset each other. It's just the opposite with Margot, whom he likes very much. Mummy sometimes treats me just like a baby, which I can't bear. Otherwise, things are going better. I still don't like Peter anymore. He's so boring. He flops lazily on his bed half the time, does a bit of carpentry, and then goes back for another snooze. What a fool. It's lovely weather, and in spite of everything, we can make the most we can of it by lying on a camp bed in the attic, where the sun shines through an open window. Yours, Anne. So, a couple of things. I want to see if I can show you again the door. So originally she talks yesterday about how there's a door, there's a gray door. But then this bookcase is added and you can see how it sort of swings out. This is a picture of it as it was in the 40s. And this is a picture of it today in the Anne Frank Museum. You can see how it's very cleverly done. The bookcase looks like it's just up against a wall. This map hides the top of the door casing, and unless you knew it swung out, you wouldn't be tempted to look behind the door. You can actually see part of the door, the gray door right here, and then the bookcase built on top of it. So it's a very clever system to keep them all hidden. The thing that again strikes me is how well she's dealing with all of these really swift changes, all this really scary times, and the uncertainty of not knowing what's going on in the world outside, not knowing if they'll be found, not knowing if their secret plan to get away is going to work or not. And I just find myself thinking a lot about how her situation is a lot more dire than my situation. And although there may be some similarities, I have a lot more freedom and a lot more explanation of why what's happening is happening. So I find comfort in that. Again, if you're a student of mine, I'm going to post some work in Teams. Or if you're not a student of mine, I will post the discussion questions below in the comment section. And I thank you for spending some time with me today, thinking about and reading a little bit of the Diary of Anne Frank. It's good to see you today. I'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.